Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Lee Doran, and this is going to be something totally different from what you've heard before. It's in the guise of broadening the vista, but broadening it in a different way, perhaps, than other people have been thinking about it. My background, and I won't read all this, is an environmental consultant for many decades, basically working on environmental impact assessments, which forced me over my career to read and understand to the point where I could edit into volumes more and more disciplines in the environmental field. So I started out in fisheries, and then I did animals, and then I did biophysical, then I incorporated social. So I think I have learned to think in a multidisciplinary way or intradisciplinary way, perhaps, which many people claim to do, but very few actually do. Most people take interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary grants and do the same old thing they've always done before. So my background then is an applied science. The point of environmental assessment is to write a document that can go to a regulatory environment and result in a decision on a project, whether the project goes ahead or not. As I say, multidisciplinary and in some sense integrated. I mean, in the end, the tribunal has to come up with a single decision, so it isn't as if trade-offs have to be made, and sometimes caribou override people, but often it works another. But in some sense, the whole thing has to be integrated. I got on this tack through Naomi Klein's 2014 book, Capitalism versus the Climate, an obvious challenge. This changes everything, capitalism versus the climate. There's an obviously some kind of challenge there to capitalism, which is more or less her thesis, I think, that it's destroying the global climate in some way and requires some kind of perhaps revolutionary action. My background to this was that I audited Jonathan's course in 2012. I thought it was totally amazing, as I thought once again today. I mean, how the qualitative and the quantitative come together in a social science. That actually, this is the thing that blew my mind and continues to. And I kind of give talks on this stuff occasionally, and it blows everybody's mind. That a social science could 3 times in advance, in writing, predict oil wars in the Middle East. It's an amazing challenge, I think, to other social sciences to try and be equally responsive or responsible, perhaps. So my response to Naomi Klein was to say, Jonathan should write the book, should write the response. I actually met her at an author's event, and I said, have you read this book, Capitalist Power? And she says, no, people keep telling me I ought to read that book. And I said, yeah, you should read that book, because that book, if you married, your central thesis with an understanding of how capitalism actually works, which you can get from reading Capitalist Power, you'd have an awesome thesis. I don't know if she read it or not. So my response was to write a little book. It's really just a kind of a vanity book, self-indulgent, but partly to explain that in more lay terms than you people generally talk, how capitalist power works and what perhaps some of the implications of that might be. So what I'm going to do now is just highlight a couple of topics from the book. Obviously, I can't do the whole thing, to just give you some flavor of the thing. I began with what's been called Milton Friedman's dumbest idea. In 1970, he wrote a New York Times magazine article, interestingly enough, saying that the social responsibility of business is to increase its profits. Full stop. There was no other social responsibility of business. And in, very shortly thereafter, we had Ronnie and Maggie running the world, running the major economies of the Western world. Ronald Reagan said in his first inaugural speech, government is the problem, not the solution. And Maggie, Mrs. Thatcher, even more famously perhaps, was once quoted as saying, there is no such thing as society. There are only men and women and families. So clearly, by 1976, Milton Friedman had won the Nobel Prize for economics. It's not actually the Nobel Prize, but it's a comparable prize for economics. And I guess it became a kind of orthodoxy that allowed the neoliberal group power to get us where we are now. I mean, we've had 30, 40 years of it, and I guess we just heard today from Jonathan again that it's looking more risky and threadbare than and people have thought it was. So maybe it is time for a change on all various fronts. Okay, switch to another topic just very quickly. In the 1970s, we had two other things going, two other major developments, I think, that impact on my way of thinking about these things. One was the environmental movement, which is largely sparked in the minds of many by Rachel Carson's book. There were many other forces, of course, and resulted in the 70s in the setting up of environmental bureaucracies around the world. And we had laws, and both in here, we had them both provincially and federally. Bureaucracies were set up. The environmental movement was kickstarted by, came to fruition in the 70s, really, when I first started doing environmental work on the basis of Silent Spring. And now, arguably, is mature. I mean, it's a mature discipline. I know much less about it, but I think the same argument could be made about feminism. It developed perhaps more slowly over more years, but once again in the 70s, we began to see the setting up of university departments with feminist foci. And I think now, and I try and argue a little bit in the book, that feminism is also mature, not only on its own terms, but in the terms of the other disciplines that it critiques. I think of Gibson Graham, who wrote the book called The End of Capitalism as We Know It, I think, or some title like that. It's 20 years old now, and probably little read by economists is my guess, but a very, very interesting and I found very educational view of economics from a feminist perspective. The subtitle of the book is A Feminist Perspective. So once again, I think both these trends impact on where we are, probably at least in our mind. Wolf had a name for it, that the overall view that we have of the world kind of thing, and maybe also is reflected in some of the economic crises we're having or are about to have. Cut break again. You probably all know that in 2009, Eleanor Ostrom won one half of a Nobel Prize. They wouldn't give her a whole prize. They gave her one half of a Nobel Prize in economics. And what I think she demonstrated, or the reason for receiving the award, in my view, was she figured out by empirical studies of communities and groups and lands and land resource use around the world, how it's possible to manage what she called common pool resources in a non-hierarchical, non-traditional sort of way, without the kind of institutions that are always been assumed to be necessary by others. So here are the principles. I don't know if I need to go through them all. Boundaries, management rules, inclusive decision-making, monitoring with feedback, graduated sanctions for violations, conflict resolution being available, self-determination by communities recognized by higher authorities, multiple layers of nested enterprises for larger common pool resources. So, and that sounds very much like a modern-day impact assessment document, for example, including social as well as environmental, biophysical. So it's a very comprehensive take on the world, and apparently it was worth half a Nobel Prize, so must have some value to the rest of the world, although I think, once again, I'm not sure it's being taken too seriously in the economics profession, for example. Just one more quick example. I enjoy reading Michael Mann's Sources of Social Power. I think there's four volumes of the book now. His framework is four parts: ideological, economic, military, and political. In the last book, he talks a lot about climate change as a global issue to be addressed, and considers whether he should include other criteria in his four-part, his IEMP system, and decides not. He looks at technology, he thinks about science, he thinks about various things, but ends up with his four sources. Once again, I would be really interested to think about how a CASP view of the world, as taken as perhaps the primary economic criterion, would integrate with some of these others and I tried a little bit in that. I tried to use the Mann framework in the U.S. to look at how they moved from Eisenhower's warning about the military-industrial complex in the 50s, which now looks very prescient, I think, to the point now where you could argue that almost, it's not only military-industrial, it's actually almost all these four factors are under the control of one or a very small group of people at this point. So again, just a very interesting perspective from my point of view. This is back to the traditional environment these days, and I'll just end here, actually. Something called corporate social responsibility has come along. It came out of the whole sustainability movement, which started in 1987 with a book called Our Common Future. Sustainability will be 30 years old next year. I'm sure we'll hear lots about that. And it's been developed in many ways to either to justify or to sabotage the environmental movement around the world. I don't think I need to say any more about that. I mean, sustainability is everywhere. You know, there are these rankings that the 100 most sustainable companies in the world, and I bet you'll never guess who came out on top. The top Canadian firm, of the top 100, the top Canadian firm in 2015, the most sustainable company in Canada. Tim Hortons. Another trend in the U.S., which is perhaps interesting and perhaps more positive, is the so-called B corporation, the benefit corporations, which are now allowed in at least 30 states. It's probably more than that now. And what these are is it allows corporations to write social and environmental objectives directly into their letters patent, their objectives, so that in the past, my understanding is shareholders could sue the corporation for not maximizing profit, which was the objective of all corporations for, I guess, hundreds of years. So this idea that you could have social objectives and, or environmental objectives, which were part of the corporation's mandate, meant that presumably the world has changed. And a lot of people are doing it. Even people in Ontario are doing it, even though it's not possible legally in Ontario. Okay, I just made this up the other day to suggest, and this is the next to last slide, two current trends, which since I was engaged with this in the book, this whole Volkswagen thing has blown up, as it were. It seems to me a major case study of great interest because it was corporate policy. It was designed by corporate people. I mean, it wasn't like Exxon Valdez, which was a mistake. I mean, a lot of the environmental crises we've had in the world, Bhopal even, you know, these things were mistakes. This was designed corporately to subvert the regulatory process. And then they also went around and subverted the regulators as well. But I mean, to me, that morally, ethically, some major shift has happened when people figure they can actually, they're allowed to actually design systems to co-op. On the other hand, Unilever, I worked a lot at the World Bank, private sector arm of the World Bank, on human rights and similar policy issues. And they were usually environmental issues, resettlement of people, biodiversity, air and water quality, all that kind of stuff. But one of the intractable ones was human rights. What role did the private sector have in human rights? And they backed off from it. Nobody wanted to touch it. The World Bank never encouraged involvement with it. Around the edges, people were working on it for many, many years, actually. And Unilever, apparently a year ago, responded to significant NGO allegations of, I think it was sexual harassment. I don't know exactly the details. And revamped their whole corporate policy and procedure to actually consider substantively, according to people that I've talked to, people who are aware of this issue and its importance, in a responsive way. So on the one hand, we're getting more immoral, if you like. On the other hand, people are, and where are we going to end up? I mean, who knows? So this is it. My conclusion is capitalism reigns. I don't see the revolution coming. You know, I mean, I just don't see it. I used to hope for the revolution. I think Naomi Klein is of the revolutionary mindset, you know, that we have to have the revolution and then everything will change. I don't see the revolution. I see morphing. We're gonna morph from where we are now into some kind of future, which is probably going to be capitalist, because capitalism reigns and runs the world. It's going to be a different variety of capitalism, presumably. In my view, you know my view. CasP aids in our understanding of what's happening now. And I think it's positioned to demonstrate to all the social scientists what they need to do to bring us all together in some kind of multidisciplinary way for the future. Thanks very much.
Hello, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about Piketty. in my presentation. I want to make just one point, and it is this. The capitalist power approach would help Thomas Piketty fix his incoherent theorization in his Capital in the 21st Century, thereby making the book live up to its name. But I'm not sure whether he wants my help. So, but I would like to help him. I agreed with Paul Krugman when he hailed the book as a revolution in our understanding of long-term trends in inequality. The huge amount of the data Piketty collected, the statistical method he developed, a bold attempt he made to theorize the laws of motion of capitalism, really deserve the so-called Piketty phenomenon. However, I think Piketty's great achievement was overshadowed by his poor theorization of the causality of the ever-growing inequality. Piketty's theory of capital in the book fell short of the title, Capital in the 21st Century. The key problem lies in the fact that he put new wine into old bottles. In other words, having recourse to the mainstream economics, when he theoretically interpreted his research findings, Piketty deviated from the planned path to capital of the 21st century and returned to the orbit of capital of the 20th century. There is a contradiction between what he said and what he did. On the one hand, defining economics as a sub-discipline of social science, alongside history, sociology, anthropology, and political science, he criticized the mainstream economics harshly for its mathematical approach. On the other hand, he relied on the production function of the mainstream economics when he was theorizing the embedded mechanism of deteriorating inequality. I think it is the capitalist power approach that enables, can enable Thomas Piketty to get out of the trap of the 20th century and to get back on the right track to the 21st century. Thus, from now on, I'm going to try to cast a new light on Piketty's revolutionary research on inequality from the viewpoint of capitalist power. As we know, Piketty regards deteriorating inequality as one of the most serious social problems, as we can see from the chart. By the way, this chart is very familiar to us by now, so I'm not going to in detail. So he excellently demonstrated the long-term trends of inequality by tracing the concentration income into the highest income group back to more than a century ago. Despite the differences in degrees among the countries, it is clear that since the post-World War, inequality has been aggravating. Piketty discussed the distribution of income in more details by further dividing the top income group into top 1% and the top 0.1% and so on. In all the chart, we have a trajectory of inequality, which can be called reversed Kuznets curve. Disapproving Kuznets, Piketty argues that the decrease in inequality in the post-World War period was an exceptional phenomenon, which was created by the social, special socio-political circumstances at the time. Piketty went further to say that the 21st century would witness further widening gap between rich and poor. He predicted the future path of inequality like the chart. Here, we have to look at the vertical axis. It represents the ratio of the value of private capital to world income in percentage terms. Piketty thought that it will be rising throughout the 21st century, yet what does it have to do with deteriorating inequality? Piketty explained the relationship between the ratio and the inequality by introducing three fundamental laws of motion of capitalism. The first law is alpha equals R multiplied by beta. Here, alpha is the share of income from capital in national income. Beta is the capital income ratio. R is the rate of return on capital. But the question is this a law? There is no mysterious reason for that, but by definition, this is just an identical equation. I provide how we can get alpha equals R multiplied beta as an identical equation, yet we don't have to understand the process. We may skip this part. What is important is the reason why Piketty called the simple identical equation a law of motion. He wanted to argue that if the value of beta increases, then alpha also increases. From this relation, he wanted to draw a conclusion that inequality would aggravate inevitably. Yet, the first law is not enough for this mechanism. Thus, Piketty introduced the other two laws of motion of capitalism that ensure ever-growing beta and alpha. Here is the second law. Beta equals S divided by G, where S is the saving rate and G is the rate of growth. Piketty adopted Harold Domas and Solow's formulation of the condition for balanced growth. Originally, the equation was written as follows, G equals S divided by beta. This equation is meaningful only in an idealized model of economy, where beta is fixed by the available technology with fixed coefficients and no possible substitution between labor and capital, like in the Cobb-Douglas production function. Then economic growth depends solely on saving rate. Again, we have the process, how we can get the equation, but what is important is the reason why. This is not important. Why Piketty wanted to define this as a law. We can put the first and the second law together. Then we have the following formula. Alpha equals R multiplied by beta equals R multiplied by S divided by G. Now we have this formula, and we know that alpha, the share of income from capital in a national income, depends on the relative relations between R, the rate of return on capital, S, saving rate, and G, growth rate. Piketty wants to talk about inequality in terms of R, S, and G. Now Piketty has to show the relations between R, S, and G. In order to that, he introduced the third law of motion of capitalism. That is, R is always bigger than G, where R is the rate of return on capital, G is the rate of growth. Piketty called it the central contradiction of capitalism. It is central because the relationship between R and G determines alpha, which in turn shapes the degree of inequality. In order to prove R is bigger than G, he offered the historical data of the rate of return on capital and growth rate. According to Piketty, R has been maintained around 5% throughout history, and predicted this will be the case in the 21st century. In the picture, the upper line chart represents pure rate of return to capital before tax. The lower one represents the growth rate of world output, is G. In the next chart, there's a tax and capital losses are considered. And this chart is the average of the first and second chart. Although there was an exception in the post-World War period when G was higher than R, Piketty argues it is historically true that R is always higher than G. It will be the case throughout the 21st century. The reasons are as follows. As population decreases, so does growth rate. Then more capital will be put into the production process. It increases beta, while alpha is maintained around 5%. Saving rates will be constant over the long term. Therefore, Piketty argued the three laws of motion of capital, inevitably leads to a situation in which inequality would aggravate along with the increases of beta and alpha in the 21st century. There have been a lot of criticism from both the mainstream and the Marxist camps against Piketty's argument. Yet I cannot derive all the controversies. I just want to address fundamental issues here. First and most, regardless whether Piketty's laws are true or not, it has little to do with inequality. His conclusion is just that the increase of beta, the capital income ratio, leads to that of alpha, the share of income from capital in national income. It does not tell us anything about distribution. The increase of alpha means the increase of capital income relative to labor income in national account. It does not automatically lead to the increase or decrease of inequality. I'm sorry, but I can say that Piketty made much ado about nothing. A key problem lies in his approach. He approached to inequality not in differential terms, but in aggregate terms. All the variables in his formula, such as R, G, S, and alpha and beta, are macroeconomic indicators which cannot tell us anything about distribution. The so-called central contradiction of capitalism, R is bigger than G, just means that the average rate of return on capital is higher than the rate of national income growth. It has little to do with inequality. In order to know about inequality, we have to approach to income and wealth in differential terms. The expression on the screen is not precise, but I want to say that inequality is about differential distribution. Another important problem with Piketty is that he put the cart before the horse. In other words, he confused result with causes. Macroeconomic indicators are not causes, but result, R, G, S, alpha, and beta, cannot cause something. They are numerical expressions or measurement of political economic processes of society. Therefore, identical equations among those indicators cannot be laws of motion of capitalism. From the very beginning, Piketty's approach was absurd. It's too much. Another problem is related to the concept of capital, which I think is the most important issue. It was James Galbraith who pinpointed this central problem. Quoting the Cambridge Capital Controversy, Galbraith pointed out that Piketty used two different concepts of capital at the same time without knowing the importance of the difference. This was the main issue addressed in the Cambridge Capital Controversy. Piketty dealt with this debate in Capital in the 21st century, but he misunderstood the main lesson it taught. He said, quote, "There was no real justification for the suspicions of the British." He continues, "The Cambridge Capital Controversy was due in part to the fact that participants on both sides lacked the historical data needed to clarify the terms of the debate." In the first law, the quantity of capital represents the market value of capital. Piketty defines it as the total value of private wealth in real estate, financial assets, professional capital, and net of debt. On the other hand, in the second law, the quantity of capital is measured in physical terms. The concept is derived from the production function. The conclusion of the Cambridge Capital Controversy tells us that there is no simple bridge between the two. It means that Piketty cannot link the first law to the second law without theoretical justification. Yet Piketty used the two different concepts at the same time without any explanation, as if they were identical. It turns out that his audacious attempt to formulate three laws of motion of capitalism was futile from the very beginning. Piketty woke up one morning to find he became one of the most famous people in the world. Unlike his success story, Piketty's grand project turned out to be a failure. Leaving aside the question whether global tax on capital is a plausible measure to tackle deteriorating inequality, he failed to formulate the so-called laws of motion of capitalism, which inevitably, inherently aggregate inequality. This failure raises a question whether capital in the 21st century deserves its name. In order to fix Piketty's failure, we need to have a new theory of capital. I think the capitalist power approach is the strongest candidate for that, if not the only one. From the perspective of capitalist power, it can be said that differential accumulation lies at the heart of inequality mechanism inherent in capitalism. I don't have to repeat explaining capitalist power approach again. We have, enough time to discuss it. Let me go straight to the point. Nizan and Bickel argue that the following capitalization formula is the ritual of the capitalist ruling class. This collective belief system of capitalists is the creator of capitalism, according to which society is being shaped and restructured through struggles. Considering strategic sabotage as the nature of this creator, Nizan and Bickel suggest that differential analysis of capitalization, especially the capitalization of dominant capital, would be the most effective indicator that helps us interpret changes in capitalist society. I believe that Piketty, when he attempted to find the so-called laws of motion of capitalism, must have started from differential accumulation. Thus, I have tried to illustrate the relation between differential accumulation and equality. I have this one. It's about US. So the two line chart shows a very strong correlation. The one represents differential profit that is expressed as the ratio of Fortune 500 average to corporate average. The other represent the share of top 10% in total income, that Piketty's analysis. Their Pearson's correlations coefficient is 0.899, which means a very high correlation. I tried the same analysis for Korea. The time series is relatively too short to have Pearson's correlation coefficient, yet we can say that the two charts also show a strong correlation, at least in appearance. In a sense, it is very natural to witness the strong correlations between the growing differential accumulation by dominant capital and the intensifying inequality, because it is the dominant capital that takes the lion's share and controls the distribution of societal income and wealth. Members of top income group must have relations with dominant capital in one way or another. Let me go a little bit further into detail. As we can see from the chart, the share of corporate income in national income of both South US and Korea has recently increased a lot. It is part of alpha in Piketty's formula. The point at issue is what really drives the trend. The next picture gives us a clue to the cause of increasing corporate income share. The three charts represent the share of the Korean dominant capital, Jever, in corporate income. The chart shows that the recent rise of corporate income share was driven by dominant capital, at least in Korea. Top 30 Jebol's share amounted to 55% on average during the 2000s. Who is the main beneficiary of this trend? As we expect, it is jewel families who control and manage Korea's dominant capital. The chart shows changes in the market value of top 10 jewel CEOs stock, they owned stocks, and the amount dividend given to them. Their stock value and dividend have increased about 20 times over the last 15 years. The concentration of national income into the hands of dominant capital is accompanied by a dual political economy, which means the polarization of a political economy into big business and organized labor on the one hand, and the small economy and unorganized workers on the other. This polarization leads to the widening income gap between two groups of workers. The chart shows the ratio of medium enterprise workers' average income to large enterprise workers' average income. It was 77% in 1984. It dropped to 54% in 2012. Another chart. I forgot to click. Yeah, okay. Another chart represents a comparison of average income between irregular workers in medium firms and full-time regular workers in large firms. In 2004, irregular workers in medium firms received 47% of the irregular workers' average income. The number decreased to 41% in 2014. By the way, the irregular workers in Korea accounts for about 60% of labor force. I just want to show that the increase of alpha, that is share of national income from capital, is not enough to argue the inevitable aggravation of inequality through this chart. In sum, differential approaches to inequality would offer much better understanding and theorization of the so-called laws of motion of capitalism that aggravate inequality. I think capitalist power perspective would be the best approach, which enables Thomas Piketty complete his project. Yeah, I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you both. We have about 20 minutes for questions or comments. Okay, there's one over here.
June, I think that's amazing work. Really well done. I think you're the first one that I know of anyway that's actually taken a close look at what Piketty's actually got up to. So my question's really just, maybe twofold. One, do you have this in preparation for publication, and are you looking at other data other than Korea? And then two, where would you push the analysis forward? Like how would you envision a conversation between, say, people who work within the capitalist power framework and a relatively mainstream, though, maybe arguably open-minded economist like Thomas Piketty and his cohort? So those are the two questions I have for you. And I'm sorry if I'm not there. And Doran, I really enjoyed your presentation as well. And I was wondering if you, I think there are gaps, obviously, in the capitalist power framework. And I think they mostly have to do around understandings of money. I was just wondering if you've ever encountered or read the work of C.H. Douglas.
Yeah, I'll go first. I published my paper last year in Korea. It's written in Korean, and analysis is focused on Korea, as you said. So. Yeah, I want if I can update the data analysis and expand my analysis into other countries and reorganize work and I will write the paper in English, and hopefully I'm going to send it to you. And about the second question, I hope, as I said, I want to help guys like Thomas Piketty to have the approach of capitalist power and develop their ideas and research findings, have a better understanding or interpretation of their researches. So, but I'm not sure they want to take my offer. So, but your point is that we need to have an open-minded, yeah, towards other the perspectives and other groups who try to be progressive. Yeah. So yeah, I agree with you. We need to have an open mind to other perspectives. So try to embrace, yeah, other trends.
No, I haven't read C.H. Douglas, and probably should. There's a whole lot of stuff I should read. My issue wouldn't. I wasn't focusing so much on gaps in CASP as links with other disciplines, and that's just a belief of mine because I've spent my life doing it, and it seemed to work out. You know, perhaps the most prominent example, just quickly, would be. Somebody take a look at the feminist takes on power. I mean, feminism is all about power and power distributions. And how does that link to the fact that this room is full of mostly men? Very few females study economics. I mean, you know, there's a whole bunch of things, but there's also the basic difference between male and female that plays out in power relationships. So, I mean, I would love to see somebody who could put those two together, never mind the environment and all the other stuff. And wouldn't that be awesome?
Yeah. Okay. Just also thank you for the presentations. Just to Yuli, a remark and the question about the book you published. A remark, I think, is what I think about the capitalist power approach to like general movements about reformism and revolution, yeah, is I think that the approach limits the perspective, so to say, for reform. Because if you reform the system just, you know, in a minimal way, you basically keep the whole power process in going on, and you basically don't achieve anything. I think that was, for me, when I met this, the most decisive thing, yeah, so that all the reformisms basically don't change anything. I don't know if you're dealing with that. The second is you, do you have your book here, and did you also contact the people here who do the capitalist power research, so they have a look at it, so that it's all good?
Sure, I have the book. I never travel without my book. Okay. And it's only $10 from me. It's $15 everywhere else. Sorry, what was the first point that on?
The first one was only that the capitalist power was limited.
Yes. See, my views on that are, I guess, from a different perspective. If people have read Steven Pinker, the better angels of our nature. And you don't have to accept all his environmental psychology, but if you look at his trends in the reduction of violence, you can see that happening all over the world, in every economy, in every country, or many countries, especially this one, despite our previous government. So I think not only are we, and this is bold and ridiculous to say probably, but I think a projection of Pinker's evidence, and feminization is a part of his, one of his reasons for the reduction in violence around the world. I think we're done with violent revolutions on a major scale. They're only going to be happening locally and regionally. absent a nut who has his finger on the button, which might be close, you know. Otherwise, I don't think we're going to. I think we've. If you recall those Hong Kong students, they were revolting, but they went. They did their homework and they cleaned up their litter every day. That's the model for the future of revolution, in my view. Nonviolent.
And just a quick question. I was wondering about the critical reception, to the extent that there was any, to your article in Korea about Piketty's work.
Actually, I don't know how many people read my paper. So, academic journal, I mean, it's a closed circle thing, so not much any response to my article, yeah. So I don't know about that.
So I have two questions for you, Doran. My first question is, instead of, like, so the left, generally speaking, or critical-minded people, always blame this word, capitalism. Capitalism's responsible for climate change, as Naomi Klein points out in that book. Capitalism's responsible for patriarchy, which is, generally speaking, most of what feminism has to say, like until you get to critical race feminism and other sketches of feminism. Why don't people ever look at their own everyday lives and maybe blame how we socially reproduce our lives using a feminist lens, so how violent it is, right? So, for example, my work is on the tar sands, right? And here is a place about the size of England that we have dug up, totally destroyed on indigenous land, and we don't even rectify that it is on indigenous land, right? So, like, do you see any ways that people should maybe, instead of always blaming these abstract concepts, should actually take a look at their own internal lives and how they live their lives as a form of revolution? I had another question, but I actually forgot it.
Was that a question? I mean,
Yeah, I think it is, because, like, most people just blame capitalism. Oh, my life sucks because of capitalism, right? Without actually looking at how, especially here in the global north or the west, capitalism makes our lives really awesome, actually. We can fly over the world. We can buy anything we want, right? We take it for granted. Like, and we externalize all the costs onto the environment, on cheap labor, on raw resources and all that. Instead of just simply saying, let's blame capitalism, as Naomi Klein says we should. I'm just saying, what leftist critique of this puts all the emphasis on capital and no responsibility on ourselves, to put it simply.
Yeah, I suppose that's true, but I'm not sure I have any comment. I mean, I stopped driving a car 15 years ago for my personal reasons, you know. But so I guess my view on that, it's which is just a hunch. I mean, I did some work on I was on a committee at City Hall, and we looked at the declines in demand in electricity, water use, and waste generation in the city of Toronto. They're all declining precipitously. They're no longer linked to the economy. They come to the city council in independent reports, so nobody ever looks at them all together. I think your average citizen is actually doing a lot that they're not getting credit for. I understand, you know, the ideology people do their thing, but I don't know what more to say. I mean,
okay, I've got one question for Hyeng-Joon. I have a Chinese background, and I'm wondering whether you could make some comparisons between inequalities of China, Korea, and Japan. Are there any similarities or differences between them? And then my second question will go to both of you. As you know, China is rising or re-rising, right, as a world power now. And between capitalism and the so-called communism, which is actually false, China has been advocating and actually in some way or sense following a middle way or middle pattern way approach. And then what you like to say on my second question, okay, for both of you. But the first question raised only for our Korean friend, okay?
Okay. I haven't done any research on China, so I don't know well about the situation of equality or inequality in China. And neither do I research on Japan, so I don't know well about Japan's equality situation. But I guess, yeah, the three countries have a similarity in terms of tradition and the way of developing economy so far, and the mindset of the ruling class are very similar to each other. So, and I don't know exactly, but I heard inequality in China is also very serious. So I don't think there are big difference in inequality between three countries. So, I mean, in future, I'm gonna, do some research on China and Japan, so I will compare three countries, yep. And also about the second question, Midway, yeah. So, there has been some theory and discourse on the economic model of East Asia. So it always it says that Japanese way of developing economy or Korean way of developing an economy has been different from that of the Western advanced countries. I think there's some differences, but in the end, Japan and Korea catch up with Western advanced countries, and the model has been converged into the similar one. So this time is the theory of particularity directed to China. China will be different. Yeah? So, but I'm not sure about that. China will be also converged into the similar model, I guess. But I don't know about the future. But I think, yeah, China will not be that different from Korea, Japan, and also advanced Western advanced countries. So in the end, China will be one part of the globalized capitalism. Yeah.
I don't think I can comment sensibly on the economies. I'm not enough of an economist. But I might say that to me, one of the, you know, from an environmental perspective, one of the big surprises of recent years was the agreement between the US and China pre-Paris. And then the fact that I'm told, or I've heard, by people who were there, that the freak out that happened at Paris. I mean, one government was having floods, another one was having droughts, and all of a sudden, by this report, the report comes from the Environmental Commissioner of Ontario, who was there, and she said they freaked out. They just realized that something had to be done. Now, whether it's ever gonna be any more done than was previously done on agreements that never went anywhere, who knows, but the fact that China and the U.S., you know, the biggest global polluters, came together on some kind of an agreement around environment, to me, is a very positive thing.
Thank you both very much. I have an information input in reference to C.H. Douglas and then a question to the second speaker. Almost everything Clifford Hugh Douglas wrote on the subject of social credit, almost everything that Clifford Hugh Douglas wrote some time back on the subject of social credit and what contemporaries of his of him wrote on the subject with analysis is all in one relatively recent website. It's called SOCRED, S-O-C-R-E-D, and it's either .org or .com, I forget which. It has been put together by a chap with a doctorate of philosophy who's, I think, originally from Liechtenstein or somewhere like that, who lives somewhere not far from here. I've been in correspondence with him, but have not met him. The other major contemporary writer about social credit is an English woman who has studied economics, recently retired. Her name is Frances Hutchinson. Frances Hutchinson. My question to the second speaker goes a little bit further than the analysis that you have articulated so well. And it's a general one apropos of inequality. So many people speak about this subject getting worse and worse and worse. When and if do you see it getting to the point that there's going to be really serious social unrest, for example, in the United States, because the subject of inequality in the US more than anywhere else is tied up with the subject of race. So this is like, you know, drops of sand, and eventually there's one straw that breaks the camel's back, so to speak. I'd welcome your comment. Thank you.
Well, Michael, that's something I have no expertise on whatsoever. But I will comment anyway. I was born an American and lived there for the early years of my life. And I would say the first thing to do is attend to the news on November 9th. Because of the situation you describe. I mean, I through my life have been waxed and waned about the hope that America might recover from its racist history and past, and I'm in a downswing now. I used to think it was you know, getting better. But this election is very big. I mean, it's a very important election, and arguably there's going to be armed factions, or at least on one side, that are going to be very disappointed if they don't win. And Americans resolve conflicts with violence. That's probably more than I should have said, but you know, it's an issue. It's a huge issue, I think.
Okay, I just want to make a general comment on what you said, rise of China and situation of inequality and so on. I think all these are arguments that remain within the framework of this rational control framework. I mean, China is, let's say, communist China is a bureaucratic capitalism. You know, there were in the 60s, 50s, 60s, theories of bureaucratic capitalism, like Castoriadis. Edit them. And we have then seen a change to financial capitalism, let's call it that way. And now we have China, where the state organizes this kind of transition. In this sense, it's no big difference, I would say, like from the United States in the 19th century, Germany, France, and so on. All these countries went through this phase of very much a state-organized capitalism to a more, less state-organized, but state-based capitalism. So I don't think that there's a big difference from China than from older capitalism. What is, I think, not happening is that there is a trend to autonomy. I think that was what you said with women's liberation, environmental, and so on. They were all, you could say, autonomy projects. Yeah. And the question, I think, would be, where are these projects now? Where are these projects in China, in Korea, and so on? That would be, I think, the important question for me. Yeah, but this is just a comment, because if you talk about inequality, you're remaining in this confined, so to say, within the system, so to say. Yeah, you don't break it, because to break it towards autonomy is not the question of whether you're rich or small. You want a different society, yeah? Where everybody is equal, in a sense of equally deciding how the society is organized and how it's going to move on. Yeah, that's fundamentally different. This has nothing to do with the inequality that exists. A very rich society could decide that they want to be an autonomous society. Yeah. Okay, I would just like to comment that there are two levels in this discussion.
Okay, it's 5:30 now. I see one more question there, and I have one as well. And I will conclude after my question. It's at the back.
Yeah.
Just to address the question about China again, there actually is an article that examines fairly closely how the Chinese economy has evolved over time and how it's no longer really just one capitalism, but several of them. And it depends in part on the region within China. It's a very large country, so there are different organizations at both the local and the regional level that are not strictly state capitalism, but have evolved over time into what they're calling kind of a family-linked capitalism, where there are certain families that have interlinks between them, and they sort of control a particular region. So there's not one, but several different varieties, and I can give you that. I can actually show you the article too as well. It's not strictly premised on the capitalist power framework. It's more of a standard neoclassical, I guess, analysis. But nevertheless, it had some interesting aspects in how it examined where China's positioned on the dual scale of state or state-controlled capitalism or more free market type of capitalism, as it's posited usually.
Okay, I had a question for Hyeng-Joon about the, I guess, the terms of analysis. I can understand why with Piketty and maybe in your own revision, you kind of remain, you have to use national statistics because that's the basis for the analysis. But what's striking about the construction of a top 1% or 0.01% is the transnational capital flows. Something like Sandy Hager's bondholder class, where the United States public debt is held within the country but also outside the country, and there's a unified bondholder class which is transnationally organized, something similar in art markets and so on and so forth. So global elites aren't nationally located. I'm wondering if there's a way of, well, two things. If it's a way of establishing the differential accumulation beyond the kind of national construction of statistic basis. Mm-hmm. And secondly, this is entirely speculative because I didn't see it in the discussion. If you have some intuitions about what that would mean for the analysis that Piketty sets up around capital concentration into the 21st century. Mm-hmm.
About the first question, so you want to find out some way in which we go beyond the national boundary and analyze the concentration of power in terms.
Yeah, almost as a methodological issue.
I'm not sure, but there must be some way of doing that. But in terms of the data, it's not easy to, have data for global analysis or transnational analysis. So that's, I think, a limit for, it's not about framework of approach. I'm not nationalist, so I don't think economy is independent, but it's easiest way to analyze not only inequality or but also differential accumulation, the national boundary is it's about the availability of data, I guess.
Just before you step in, can I just?
It's related to it.
Oh, okay.
But I recall very well from your dissertation that you actually documented the role of foreign ownership in Korea and how it changed. So maybe it's relevant to Suhail's question.
Yeah, but it's within Korea. Yeah, the transnational capital comes in and they take some part of the profit. So in that way, I can put the global aspect into the analysis of differential accumulation in Korea, but.
Yeah, no, just presumably you'd have to do a cross-country analysis in different foreign ownerships and sort of try and
match that
across.
Yeah, I have done that, but you want me to do more than that. So
oh, sure.
The global level analysis,
It'd be great. But the other issue would just be entirely speculatively, because it's kind of the wrong question for the paper that you're giving, but whether the inclusion of transnational capital flows how that would impact, add to the criticisms of Piketty that you're presenting? Because his analysis seems based very much upon nationally organized statistical correlations and so on.
I mean, I don't think there is a big difference. I mean, so already global capital operate over the world. So if we have data to analyze that, then I don't think we have different conclusion. We are going to have the same conclusion, I guess, yeah.
Let's finish. Thanks, speakers. Thank you very much.